Hello and welcome to IC. Let me give you a couple of insights into what is going on in, I guess I need this, what's going on around performance. So there's lots of data, lots of numbers in it, so I try to put this in the proper context and at each on the individual slides. And I want to talk particularly about what is changing right now in industry, and AI is one of the drivers of some of these changes. There's new workloads and a lot of changes happening right now in this space. And I want to show you what we're doing in order to basically keep up to date in technology on the hardware, the software side, and the solution sides to address some of these changes. But first, what is actually going on? So as more and more people realize, particularly when it comes to machine learning, is that storage actually becomes, in a lot of cases, the current bottleneck. So there had been many, many advancements in GPUs, people use FPGA, there is a lot of hardware excitement going on. The storage media is getting faster and faster, latencies go lower, 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 lower. The thing is, the application actually needs to be able to make use of that. So it doesn't help you if you drop latencies on a storage device by an order or two orders of magnitudes when you come from disk drives going to storage class memory. There's lots of things that happen or has to happen also in the software layers in order to essentially make use of that. So you also see that there is a lot of different workloads going on, which is also driving lots of these enhancements in the hardware. So the workloads we heard earlier today, people have billions of files. If you look at a lot of these things, is the majority of the capacity might come from a very, very small number of files. But basically, the large number of files in the system is a teeny tiny fraction of the capacity. So you see that there is lots of changes going on, and this is driven by basically all the different industries. We see this trend very, very dramatically. There is also lots of areas where interactive workloads or interactive outcomes become more and more important. It's no longer batch jobs. It's basically people run something, and only if they have the result, they can basically go to the next phase of the workflow. So latency is becoming more and more important, which is why people deploy more flash, which I think was also supported by our Intersect speaker. We see a huge increase in flash deployments in terms of capacity, and a lot of these things are simply driven by the change of the workload. So people see by deploying more flash, they get a faster time to insight, faster time into results, and that's just a trend that I believe is continued to going. We see also more and more applications operate more on a byte range area or a byte addressable area. So it's no longer people just read large sequential pieces of data. Jobs grab totally random pieces of data out of very, very large files or update random data in very, very large files. So there's a lot of problems in this area. And I'm talking particularly a little bit about IME, how we address some of these, because as James already mentioned before, when you look at IO 500, there is a lot of very, very nice proof points that actually show that what we've developed there actually is making a significant difference. So, as I said, massive change in capacity distribution. We see this all over the place with customers we're looking at. And that also is changing dynamics on what you need in terms of tiering, what you need in terms of caching capabilities on top of existing file system solutions, because you basically have to optimize for both cases. You need very, very high sequential workload capabilities of storage, but at the same time, it needs to be very, very interactive and optimized for very, very small files, massive amount of metadata, and that is a very, very big challenge to optimize for both actually opposite things in terms of what they represent to the storage layer. So I'm going to talk about a couple of different things. So we made some significant enhancements in our embedded systems for Exascaler as well as Gridscaler. There is some very specific enhancements on the software on our platforms. So SFAOS 11.5, which was coming out next month, going to have a massive change about large chunk size support. I'm going to talk a little bit in detail about that. And then lots and lots of software enhancements, some that has already been mentioned by James, which I provide some data points to, as well as around IME. So this might be, a lot of people might know about this, but I thought it's actually worthwhile talking a little bit about why these embedded platforms that DDN provides actually provide some significant difference to other solutions in the market. Because while we've seen a lot of these marketing charts, which are really great because they really dumb down the message very, very simple, a lot of people still ask me sometimes when I talk to them, is, but what, from a technology perspective, actually is the real difference here? So, okay, you embed all these things into a hardware box, but what is actually the real magic around that? Why does it make such a difference in for customers and their workloads? And so I thought I'm going to draw two pictures. I'm really bad in making pictures. James knows that. He needs to help me with that all the time. But I thought I'm going to come up with basically three slides that put side on side what most solutions are being deployed today, particularly if you look, for example, at a grid scaler deployment. So what you see here on the left is a grid scaler system with a bunch of client nodes, network, and then you basically have one of our SFA system with the storage media attached to it. What you see in the middle is a GNR solution, so this could either be an IBM ESS system or a Lenovo DSS system. So you see already here that there's some significant differences here in terms of networking hops. And then there's lots of customers out there that deploy GBFS simply on do-your-own solutions. So you buy basically a bunch of servers, you put them somewhere on the network, and then you have typically some fiber channel or InfiniBand network in between, and you basically have a controller underneath with storage media. So by just looking at the picture, you already see that there is a significance in terms of networking hops and complexity of the solution itself. So on the grid scaler side, you have a bunch of client nodes that just talk over the network over an embedded system where all the technology basically is put into the hardware itself. So as I said, that looks more like just a physical consolidation, but why do I really care what is physically consolidated and what not? So what is the other piece that makes the difference? And so the other piece that makes the difference actually goes a step deeper into the system design itself. So in order to leverage latency improvements of media, and in order to actually get the full maximum performance out of a system, there is something that most people don't really talk much about it because it's too deep of a level of detail that some people care about. But we at DDN really care about that because we really try to drive the maximum performance out of these systems at the lowest possible cost point. And so one of the things you need to pay attention to is NUMA awareness. So NUMA awareness is essentially just the locality of memory within a system. And if you look at today's systems that are used in storage as well as, you know, the computational nodes, most of these systems today have multiple NUMA regions. It's just a byproduct of having multiple sockets within the system. So why does it matter so much for storage? Well, it matters because in order to get data in and out of a system, you have in most systems cross multiple NUMA nodes. And having a remote NUMA access is a very, very big penalty for storage access in particular. Everything that is low latency, everything that needs to have very, very fast response times, the very last things you want to do is cross memory boundaries between NUMA nodes and processors all the time. So what we've done with these SFA platforms is essentially we take a two-node system that has four NUMA regions and essentially partition it into a four NUMA system. So you have basically four completely independent instances running inside. And so that way we can streamline the entire NUMA awareness by simply partitioning everything on a NUMA boundary. So if you basically run on a grid scaler, and the same is true for an exascaler system, if you operate with a single of these NSD systems or OSSs, you actually never ever technically cross a NUMA boundary because the hardware essentially binds the entire file system processes, network adapter, memory, CPU resources, SAS adapters, NVMe devices, everything to a particular NUMA node. And so basically by an architectural difference, we solve the problem that the software layer actually has, because if you think about it, it's actually a software problem. So if the software would be aware of the whole NUMA system and the layout of the hardware, you could make optimizations to not cross these boundaries too often. The problem with parallel file systems when they've been developed have never had any notion of NUMA awareness because by that time, NUMA systems didn't really exist at massive scale. So now everything is a NUMA system, and so now you need to basically fix all of these old problems in the file system layer and optimize for that. But because this is really, really hard and it's going to take many years to actually do that, in some cases people claim you have to rewrite the entire file system to actually do this properly, we decided to just solve this in hardware. So the hardware is taking care of it by simply creating these NUMA partitions, and basically every single instance on the system runs only on one particular NUMA node. And that gets us these massive performance improvements that we get out of an SFA system compared to everybody else. So and I'm going to have a couple of slides to show what impact that actually has. So this is a very, very simple test. I decided to show some of these effects of NUMA. And I don't have a competitor system here. I'm just going to talk about this so you get a better idea of it. But what this test is, which looks like a lot of text and not so important things, the one thing that is important is basically the headline. So this is a single-threaded workload that runs against a single file in a storage system, which is basically a 400NV with a single file created inside. So there's a 100-gigabyte file. There's a single client attached over the network, and all he does is he opens this 100-gigabyte file and writes randomly 4 kilobytes worth of data into it. So this runs at a very low rate. It's only 34 megabytes per second. But for people who have a little bit of background in performance, know that a single-threaded 4K workload is completely bound by latency. So you don't have any contention with anything else. So it just basically runs as fast as the round-trip time from the client to the storage media performs, and that's basically what you measure. So the performance number on the system seen from the client application is only 118 microseconds. So why is that so important? If you go to your storage vendor today, not necessarily the super low-end latency startups that try to get everything out of the system, but to a system that is typically deployed in HPC or enterprise-class storage systems, when you ask them for round-trip latency time for their high-end storage arrays, it's typically somewhere between 200 and 300 microseconds. So this 180 microseconds that you see here is through the file system layer, not just the block layer, and includes the entire round-trip time over the network. So in optimizations and latencies like that, you really only get if you optimize the entire stack end-to-end, and that's how you get these great results. So the same on a read, also here, the time's 146 microseconds. The reasons these are more expensive is simply you're not just acknowledging something inside the cache of the controller. You actually have to go down to the media to randomly read it. And so there's a slight addition of latency from the customer workload's perspective. And so if you take on the same box the NUMA awareness out, I just did this for an experiment, you see a performance difference of at least 20 to 30%. So it's basically 20 to 30% without any contention that you're gaining by having this full NUMA awareness. Under contention, the performance benefits actually get much, much better, or the penalty gets even worse, because then the system is very, very busy and very, very consumed just dealing with synchronization of all these different sockets. And so the performance benefit, as I said, is huge, but it's even bigger under very high load and very high contention. Okay, switching topics a little bit. As I said, in SFAOS 11.5, we made a significant change on chunk size support. So a little bit of history here. So historically, SFA has never really supported larger than the 250K chunk size. So the chunk size is basically the smallest increment of data that the RAID controller is handling internally when it does I/O to an individual drive for a RAID stripe that has been written or read from the system. So grid scalar performance was always in the past reported by DDN in cluster mode for the simple reason if you run in cluster mode, you typically get much, much better sequential performance. But a lot of customers and even competitors, including me at the time I was working back at IBM, always pointed out that if you run in cluster mode over time, the system performance degrades. So when I joined DDN, I said, well, why don't we just basically address the fundamental problem underneath it? Because if you run at a larger scale system, the benefits of cluster basically become smaller and smaller. So what you actually really want to optimize the system for is to have consistent performance under scatter mode, which is truly random workload distribution across the system. And so essentially we decided then, okay, let's just implement a larger chunk size support that supports up to 2 megabytes, which gives you basically a native 16 megabyte file system block size support, and see what benefits we get out of that. And so I have a couple of data points for that that I want to share. It's a very busy chart. I'm just going to point out a few very simple things here. So this is an 18K setup, SFA 18K, 408 HDDs, running with that new version of 11.5, which again is not released yet, but will be released pretty soon. It runs with 8 DCR pools. Each is basically 51 drives with a power rebuild of 1. It's a RAID 6 with a 2 megabyte chunk size setup. So we attached 16 clients to this over EDR, and so we created a huge amount of data, basically exceeding all caches combined by more than a factor of 10, and then we run basically some tests on it.
And so we figured out, again, you will never be exposed to all that detail. So this is something where we just internally measured what is the optimal setup for the default setup of systems going forward. And so what we basically found out is that when we use an HTC 2 in the setup, we will get a very, very nice balance between IOR and ISO numbers, and we get basically the best numbers. There's lots of different variations where you can optimize for reads and writes, but what you really want is you want to pick the setup where you get the most homogeneous performance for every workload. You don't really care that much about 1% more here or 1% more there, as long as it's nicely homogeneous and balanced. So if you do the math on this, you get about 150 megabytes per second per HDD out of that system now. So if you compare that to competitor systems, usually when you run at scatter mode across these large number of drives, you won't get more than, even in the best systems out there, more than 100 megabytes per second for truly random workload against a file system solution. I'm not talking about sequential, I'm talking about random. And so with these changes, we now achieve 150 megabytes per second, which per individual drive, which I claim we are at least 40% faster than basically any other file system solution that you're going to find out there for truly 100% large block random workload. So we also tried to see, this was a grid scaler number on the previous chart. Obviously, we want to see what benefits you're going to get out of an exascaler configuration there as well. And so we've done some testing here, and we also noticed that on exascaler, we can actually do some even higher improvements by increasing the RPC size as well on how big of an individual chunk the client is going to submit and send to the server side. And so what you see here is basically some tests done by Suichi with different RPC sizes on the system. And you see that now out of a single virtual disk, so a single drive that is basically exposed to the OSS, we will see some significant improvements by going from a smaller RPC size to a larger RPC size. And the key thing is, out of a single 18K with this setup, with a very small number of drives, we basically got in excess of 70 gigabytes per second performance out of that. So we got at peak 71 gigabytes per second on write, and we got on peak 74 gigabytes per second on read. If you pick the one that is, you know, the best out of both worlds, it's basically the last one. So you get about 70 writes and 74 reads per second. This is, again, out of a system with only a little bit more than 400 drives. So it's a very, very high performance per drive coming out of this system configuration. So IOPS, again, I will start talking at the beginning about how workloads shift. Latency is becoming more important. Making a couple of microseconds improvement on large bandwidth transfers is not very important. Where it matters a lot is on random performance, random reads, random writes, particularly of very, very small size. So for our upcoming XR5 release, we've put some very dedicated work on figuring out where is latency actually spent in exascaler, and how can we significantly reduce latency and therefore in return improve random read and write performance of very, very small files and metadata in general. And so there was a lot of work being done by the Lustre team. And so they basically done some optimizations. And what you see here is basically comparison between the 2.10 release and the 2.12 release that has been used. There was also a test where basically we eliminated the limitation of the storage hardware, which is very fast hardware. So we used a DDNAi 200 system, which is a 20 drive NVMe. It's a 24 drive, but we only had 20 NVMe drives inside the system. And so what you see basically is the difference of various block sizes. So, and the biggest impact and the most important one to look at is basically 4K. So 4K is typically seen for metadata operations, teeny tiny file operations. And you see that basically between the individual releases, we got a significant jump of about 37% by just making software changes. So this is no change in hardware. The only change is really just client-side improvements on the exascaler side, the Lustre software stack in exascaler. And you can see we get about almost 70% efficiency if you assume that your storage would be as fast as memory, because the top line number that you see is basically memory speed of transferring data just into memory instead of actually going to the media. So massive improvement in just software, and essentially as soon as Exascaler 5 is coming out, and you upgrade your systems, you're going to see a massive improvement of single-threaded and low-thread count latency numbers for metadata operations as well as small read and write operations per second. IO 500. So over the last couple of months, we spent some significant amount of time figuring out how to improve on latency and small file performance, as I mentioned. And one way to demonstrate that is to participate in the IO 500 benchmark. So the IO 500 benchmark has a very interesting set of workloads. You see a lot of teeny tiny metadata operations. You see a lot of bandwidth requirements. And the only way to get a really, really good score is if you basically are good in both. You need to be good in random read-write metadata performance as well as bandwidth. So we took that challenge. I have to put a footnote down here. So I'm comparing the results that we achieved against systems that have been published before. So I cannot give you any ranking because the new ranking has not been released. So I'm not trying to tell you we're the fastest and number one in anything. All I can tell you is these are results that have been seen before, and these are scores that we can achieve now. If these numbers are actually the final numbers when the list gets published, we don't know until Thursday when the list gets published. But we're very confident that we're going to get a pretty good score, but we really don't know what the score yet is because it has not been released. Oh, sorry, tomorrow. Okay, good. Technology challenge throughput. So if you look at what the current leader is doing right now, this is basically the bluish color here. We've done a wide variety of tests because we have customers that run Gridscaler, we have customers that run Exascaler, we have customers that run IME. So we basically try to provide as much data points as possible so customers can pick the right solutions for what they really want to deploy and what their workload is and what their preference of potential file system is as well. So this is just a subset of the benchmark numbers. So I've picked the IOR, easy write, hard write, easy read, and hard read numbers here. Just to give you, you know, some of the subsets, we have lots of more charts to talk about the other workloads. But what you see here, basically, the current top one spot basically achieved that result. And as you can see, with all the new data points that we've measured, we by far exceeded the numbers that have been published by the system before. One thing to note in particularly is this one here, as well as this one over here. These are basically the IME numbers, and you can see very clearly that there is a substantial difference, orders of magnitudes essentially, between traditional backend file systems and an IME solution. So if you have a hard read and a hard write workload, IME by far dwarfs basically every other submission on the system, even at a very, very small scale. Because, you know, you can easily build a system that has unlimited resources and unlimited amount of budget to make it very, very fast. The interesting thing on the 10-node challenge is that the system is small. It's only 10 nodes. And so being able to show this massive amount of difference between every other submission and a submission with IME, if you have this very particular problem, it's obviously a very, very good indication that it's going to make your system run much, 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 much faster if you would insert an IME layer into your infrastructure. So 10-node challenge again, showing other parts of it. This is basically the whole subset. I only provided that for correctness. I'm not going to read you through all the individual pieces of data. One thing I did in particular was wanted to show a comparison between what the current leading system does in a configuration we set up with Gridscaler. So this is not the top result we achieved. The top result we scored was with an Exascaler solution combined with IME as a front end before that. But what was very unique about this configuration is I wanted to show a configuration that is 100% laser focused on latency. So we did set up something that I found a very interesting experiment. So we basically set up two 400NV systems. We connected them to 10 Intel compute nodes on it, and we ran the IO 500 benchmark. Interestingly, even with the configuration we set, the performance was limited by the available space because I've picked the fastest media that you could pick for the test, which were Optane drives. And so the problem was the drives basically ran out of capacity before the IO 500 benchmark was finished. So, but that caused some interesting thought train in my head. I thought, well, let's see not how I can make the fastest system, but how I can make the system that gets the highest scores with the smallest resources consumed. Because I thought that is an interesting experiment as well. And what can we do to show some of the superiority of our platform? And so when we configured the system, we only configured it with three threads. So these are all multi-core systems. So we basically used only three cores on the machine to run the benchmark to show how much workload we can get done with as little as 30 threads running across the entire cluster. And so when you look at the 10-node challenge, the current leader, and the score they reported, they use 70 threads per client. So they have the same 10 clients we have, where we run only three. But their storage system consists out of 32 servers. So there are 32 servers. Each server has multiple NVMe drives inside. And so we basically use two SFA systems with 10 clients and three threads. So if you put this on a table and compare that, so even with the three threads running, we only beat the existing current leader by one score point. So that doesn't sound very impressive. The thing that is impressive, if you look at the rest. So we use 30 threads while the current leading system used 700 threads. So there's only 1/20th of the thread count required to basically achieve the same result, which directly translates into latency and, you know, basically return of information or return of data. We used four controllers in the system, which is only basically two storage systems technically, but four control nodes inside, whereas they were using 32. So that's 1/8 the number of controllers. The drives we use is 48 versus 196. Rack units consumed 4 versus 32. Switch ports consumed 8 versus 32. And one of the things that is actually quite shocking, if you look at the power consumption, because power, as we know, is a really big problem. Rack space is a problem. Power is a very big problem. So we use about 1,800 watts for that, while the competing system is using something close to 26 kilowatt, basically to achieve a result that is 2% lower than the result we achieved with the system. So I found this a very nice comparison, because it just shows you what you can do if you focus on very, very efficient design and build something that actually gets the job done at the smallest footprint, a much, much lower cost point, and at the same time saves some significant amount of power. So this is just two different views to the data, and I know I'm running out of time very quickly here. So this is just basically two different viewpoints on what the performance is achieved in various views. So this is basically the score per server, which I found an interesting comparison because, as I said, there are 32 servers in the system. We use basically only two storage systems in the back with a much, much lower number of drives. And so you see a very, very huge difference between them. So overall, very quick. Again, this is data from a previous IO500 submission, so I'm not claiming that we changed anything on the ranking or numbering here. I just want to put a couple of performance numbers here. And what this shows is the easy versus hard writes for each of the systems that are on the top 500 list. So this here is the current number one system. It's the GPFS system from Oak Ridge, the Summit system, has a massively high score on the easy write side. The hard write score is so small that you don't even see the number. It's the same on the Cambridge Lustre system. And as you can see, the IME system in the submission are the only ones, including the one at the end, that actually have some decent comparison between hard and easy I/O in general. So to put this in a slightly different perspective, we changed the layout of the slide a little bit. And what you see here is basically the ratio between the hard versus the easy in each of the categories. So this is hard versus easy in writes, as well as hard versus easy in reads. And when you look at that, you see a very, very clear point that, particular on IME, the ratio is very, very high. So you can see 0.9 basically means there is a 90% performance on the hard versus the easy ones. While if you look down here on this GPFS system or Lustre system or, you know, all these other ones that you can pick out here, there is a massive discrepancy between the hard and the easy. So most systems perform reasonably well on easy, but they perform absolutely horrible in the hard case. And as I said, given that there is a shift more and more from workloads into this hard, unpredictable, random, latency-dependent IOs, this is becoming more and more important. And with IME, we have a very, very strong technology to basically address this problem in the field. One more data point. I don't have a setup description for that, so I'm just going to talk about it for a second. So this is a test from a single DGX2 that we deployed at a customer site against a single AI400. And the only takeaway from that slide is that you can see with the increase of I/O size, essentially starting at around 256 kilobyte I/O size, you basically hit the limit of an AI400 with a single client attached to it. Even it's a very powerful client, but it's one client, and it can consume basically around 45 gigabytes per second with random I/O size of 256K. And what you see basically is also on the IOPS side, which is the other one, you see that we get half a million IOs per second into a single DGX2 with just an average I/O size of 4K. So this really takes the bottleneck away from the storage if you use this with a very, very high-performance compute platform. And it should give you enough performance to basically saturate all the GPUs in the system instead of having your GPUs constantly just waiting of data coming over the network from the storage system. So we believe that we have a very superior solution here compared to everything else that's out in the market. So a couple of takeaways. As I said, storage is a really big bottleneck for lots of workloads, particularly upcoming workloads. So you better pick a good partner and platform here. Software and constant software improvements are going to be necessary for quite a while to catch up on all these advancements that are happening on the hardware side. As I said before, it doesn't help you if you come up with 5 or 10 microsecond storage devices if the software layer cannot transport that to the client. It doesn't help you making this even faster. Software needs to improve. New software technologies need to come out to significantly improve that, like IME, which really solves that problem at the core. Skill and people matter a lot on the partner of your choice that you're partnering with, because that's where we see a huge differentiation in the field. We have very, very high-skilled people, very, very good people, and only if you have a partner that has strong people and strong skills, you're going to be successful at the end. So you need to partner with somebody that has expertise in this area, which DDN clearly had. Lots of more to talk about. I published a blog a couple of days ago. You see that on LinkedIn. We link this to a lot of social media stuff. It's worth reading it. It particularly talks about talent and skills. So feel free to take a look at that, like it, and share it. And that's basically it for now, but I'm happy to take a few more questions if time allows.